Hallelujah! Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Oh, it feels so good to say it, doesn't it? We've been withholding those hallelujahs all through Lent, and now we can let it out because he is risen. Well, in the name of our loving God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, I want to welcome you here to Atonement Lutheran Church on this foggy but very beautiful Easter Sunday. I'm Pastor Scott. We are so happy you're here worshiping with us today at this service. Jesus loves you, and so do we here at Atonement Lutheran Church. Our church family is your church family today and always. Well, today is Easter Sunday, the day that God revealed his power and love by raising his son Jesus from the dead. We want to praise him and honor him and remember how much he has blessed us in our lives. And one of the ways we do this in the season of Easter is by giving thanks for our baptisms. So that's going to be one of the first things we do here in our service. I will be going back to the font, and we will be saying a prayer over the baptismal font. And then as I process in with the choir, I will be helping you all remember your baptisms. So if it's not moist enough out there with the fog, it's going to get a little moist in here because I'll be sprinkling you with baptismal waters this morning. Just so you know, you might want to, I don't know, put your cell phones away or something while we do that part of the service. But that's what's going on if you've never been to one of these Easter services before where we do that. Well, if you haven't already, we want to invite you to look down your rows and see if you see one of those little black books on one end or the other. These are our guest books, and you are our honored guest today, so we would love it if you signed in. Let us know your name and any of the contact information you'd like us to have, and pass it down then with a smile to your neighbor sitting next to you. For those of you who are with us online, we welcome you. Those of you who are on Facebook Live or YouTube Live or Christian World Media, Jesus is risen, and we hope you are there to worship with us this morning. You also, we encourage to sign in on the chat room, little comment section there. Put your name and the number of people who are worshiping with you. And you can use that section to send messages of encouragement, greetings, or any prayer requests that you might have during the service today. We do have an announcement before we start. I want to introduce to you Christopher Welsing. Christopher, you've been working on a project, haven't you? Would you like to come up and tell us a little bit about some of the work you've been doing?
Good morning. This last Tuesday, we started our project from 9 to 5, and we were able to put a new fence, new mulching, new bench, new plants, and overall make the entire garden pretty again. So I just want to say thank you for all your donations. And after service, you are able to go over and go see, and you can open it and go and sit down. So thank you again. I really appreciate it.
Christopher Welsing is one of our confirmation students here at Atonement, but also this was his Eagle Scout project that he was going to renovate our Bartell Memorial Garden out in the front of the property. So it looks beautiful today, and I hope you have an opportunity to go take a look at it. Thank you for that, Christopher. If anybody who is here present is in need of prayer today, our God Squad prayer team members are here, and they're willing and ready to pray for you and any needs you might have. All you need to do is come up after the service and stand by the altar, and they will be here to pray with you. At this time, I would encourage you all to rise as we continue. Well, actually, we got the prelude first, right? Prelude first. You don't need to rise for that. Sorry. This is one of those calisthenic services we do. Yeah, if you get your steps in and then come to service, you got your day covered. So we're going to have the prelude, but after the prelude, we're going to ask you to rise. But you can come, you can rise and come with me, because we're going to join the choir in the back. And now you may rise. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the wellspring of grace, our Easter and our joy. Look, here is water. Here is our water of life. Hallelujah. Immersed in the promises of baptism, let us give thanks for what God has done for us. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning, your voice thundered over the deep, and water became the essence of life. Adam and Eve beheld Eden's verdant rivers. The ark carried your creation through the flood into a new day. Miriam led the dancing as your people passed through the sea into freedom's land. In a desert pool, the Ethiopian official entered your boundless baptismal life. Look, here is water. Here is our water of life. Hallelujah. At the river, your beloved son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you opened the floodgates of your reconciling love, freeing us to live as Easter people. We rejoice with glad hearts, giving all honor and praise to you through the risen Christ, our source of living water. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Look, here is water. Here is our water of life. Hallelujah. Thank you. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Have mercy on us, Lord, and hear our solemn prayer. We come to hear your living word. It saves us from despair. Have mercy on us, Christ, and wash away our sin.
Let us pray. O God, you gave your only Son to suffer death on the cross for our redemption. And by his glorious resurrection, you delivered us from the power of death. Make us die every day to sin, that we may live with him forever in the joy of the resurrection. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God. Now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated.
Good morning. Happy Easter. The first reading is from the 10th chapter of Acts. Peter began to speak to the people. I truly understand that God shows no partiality. But in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil. For God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness from sins through his name. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And we will read Psalm 118 responsibly. Give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good. God's mercy endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my song, and has become my salvation.
Shouts of rejoicing and salvation echo in the fences of righteousness. The right hand of the Lord acts valiantly.
The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord acts valiantly.
I shall not lie, but live, and declare the works of the Lord.
The Lord indeed punished me sorely, but did not hand me over to death. This is the gate of the Lord. Here the righteous may enter.
I give thanks to you, for you have answered me, and you have become my salvation.
The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
Our Lord has visited them. It is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 19 and 26. If for this life only we have hoped in Christ, we are of all people who must be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the firstfruits of those who have died. For since death has come through a human being, the resurrection of the dead has also come through a human being. For as all die in Adam, so all we will be made alive in Christ. But each in his own order. Christ the first fruits. Then, at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end. When he hands over the kingdom to God, the Father, after he destroyed every ruler and every authority, every power. For he must reign until he has put his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. The word of the Lord.
Gospel for this Easter morning comes from the Gospel of St. Mark, the 16th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint Jesus' body. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, and had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side. They were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Well, ever since the Alberts family got to church that Easter morning, their youngest, little Jerry, was starting to feel sick. Did you get into your Easter basket this morning before we left? Jerry's mom said, and little Jerry just gave her a guilty look, and she knew. Well, the organist had already started playing when Jerry said, "Mom, can we go home?" "No," his mother said. "But Mom, I think I'm going to throw up." Jerry was starting to look a little pale. His mom took a deep breath and said, "Just head back out the front door, go around the corner, and there are some bushes there. You can throw up out there, Jerry." So little Jerry got up and headed down the aisle. And then less than a minute later, he was back in his seat. His color looked much better. His mom asked, "Did you throw up?" "Oh, yeah," he said. She thought for a moment. She said, "How did you make it all the way out to the bushes and back so fast?" Little Jerry said, "Oh, I didn't even have to leave the church. I just used the box out by the front door that said, 'For the sick.'" How convenient that they had that right there. Oh, my goodness. Well, we have lots of boxes out there, but I don't think we have that one, a particular one. Actually, we've been doing a lot of gardening here at Atonement lately. We have a new group, our gardening and landscaping group, who've been doing all kinds of things to take care of our grounds around us. They have been particularly working hard out back around our columbarium, where we have the Lola Lambert Memorial Garden, which we've been improving and beautifying. We just a couple weeks ago got two new magnolia trees to put back there, and we're going to dedicate one of those. And we've also been working on our outdoor sanctuary way in the back of our property. Some of you were here with us at 6:30 in the morning when we had our sunrise service out back there in all the fog. But a couple weeks ago, we had a group that was out there cleaning and trimming and making that look nice. So we've been working on that. And you just heard about Christopher Wilson and his scouts who've been renovating our Bartell Memorial Garden out front. Thank you, Christopher, and all the hard work you've been doing. A garden, if you think about it, is a very special place. It is a place where people and God work together. You think about this. God creates and people cultivate. It is a partnership. There's sort of a covenant between God and all of nature and the gardener, who is given dominion, who is given the ability to shape that space, to arrange it. And so I've always thought of gardens as special, holy places. Places that are good, peaceful places to come. And they're just perfect spots to remember our loved ones and those who have gone before us. We see the cycle of life play out in a garden. New life is always blooming, ever growing, as old plants decay, as new ones are fertilized by the seeds and the pollen blown by the wind or carried by the insects. The Bible believes that gardens are holy places. And in fact, the Bible tells our whole human story in relation to two gardens. In the Old Testament, we hear about our first home, the Garden of Eden, where God put Adam and Eve. It was a paradise with no death and no evil. But the Lord God would walk and talk with Adam and Eve there in that garden. He would speak with his own children. He would fellowship with them. It was an amazing place, almost beyond our human comprehension. Growing in that garden were all sorts of wonderful, delicious fruits and tasty vegetables. They were rich to the taste. They were beautiful to the eye. And animals of all sorts would roam around, never threatening each other or the people there. The people who got the privilege of naming those animals. Because there was this interaction, this close relationship between God's human family and all the rest that God created. And God placed humankind at the top, for they were his most beloved creation. There in that garden, everything was in harmony. Not like any garden I've been a part of. It was all just right until the serpent came and tempted Eve and Adam, and they disobeyed. They ate the fruit of the one forbidden tree in the whole garden, the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And they were cast out into a world that was now full of death and pain. It is there in this broken world that we find that other garden that the Bible speaks of and that we hear about in our lesson today. This is a garden owned by a rich man named Joseph of Arimathea. And we hear that after Jesus died on the cross, Joseph went to Pilate to ask for Jesus' body, because he had a newly built tomb in this family garden of his that he was planning to put some relatives, but he hadn't used it yet. So he knew that there had to be a place of honor for the body of Jesus to lay, and offered his tomb as that place. And a stone was rolled across the entrance. And the governor, hearing about this, sent guards, Roman soldiers, to stand watch over this tomb. You see, this Jesus guy was known as a bit of a troublemaker. He was always talking about God and God's kingdom. And you know, when you're the king and you got a guy talking about another kingdom that was better than his kingdom, you've got some nervous kings, right? Jesus would say that the rich and the poor, they all had a place in this kingdom of God. And that loving God was less about rituals and prayers than it is about good deeds done for those in need. The true love of a true heart for God and God's people. Until just recently, Jesus had been very popular with the crowds. But all of a sudden, the people turned. They grew tired of him. And they had a new champion that they preferred to be spared. So by posting these guards, the authorities could be assured that Jesus' band of ragtag followers wouldn't try to steal that body. But this is the same Jesus that we hear in Scripture came for us to die on a cross, to love the entire world, and to be a second Adam, to do the right thing where Adam and Eve chose the wrong thing. And so John Donne, the poet who we commemorate this week, says in one of his poems that we all carry around with us the sweat of the first Adam, but the blood of the second Adam. So here we are in worship this morning, and we come here today in a similar way, for similar reasons, believe it or not, as those women did on that first Easter? Oh, it's quite different, of course. I mean, we're used to coming here and worshiping. But as those women came to that garden tomb on that first Easter morning, they came with a certain mission. They were there to tend the body of Jesus that was lying in that tomb. And they expected to find a tomb closed up and the body lying within. They expected the stone to be a problem because it would be heavy and hard to move. And then they expected to get in there and unwrap the body from the fresh linen sheet in which it was swaddled. They would anoint the body with some precious oils, burn some incense, rub some spices onto it to slow the decay. And then they would change the wrappings. They would linger a bit in their sorrow to cry over him, to lament and say a prayer for their dear friend. But eventually, they would pack up and go home. Perhaps you are here just to attend another Easter service. Well, you've been to these before. You kind of know what to expect. We're going to sit around a little. We're going to sing some hymns, say some prayers, stand up and sit down maybe one more time than we're supposed to. But then we're going to go home. And we're going to feel, okay, I've done what I could do, given the circumstances. I've made the effort to keep my faith going for this year, to tend those hopes that have occasionally inspired me, those hopes that make me long for a new world. But you know, as the years go by and we keep hoping for this new world to come, sometimes it seems to get farther and farther away. And so many of those hopes just lie there, not moving, dead as a doornail. But for old time's sake, let's go to the Easter service again. We can still come, we can still pray, we can still sing the songs, and remember that Jesus told us that with God, all things are possible. Those women on their way to the tomb that Easter, they were caught up in the routine regularity of dealing with death and loss. Something that I'm sure they had done many times before, going to tend to the bodies of their friends and their relatives and their friends' relatives and their relatives' friends, unthinking, unready for anything unusual to cross their path. And so they are very puzzled when they get to that garden and the stone has already been moved. It's already been rolled away. They can see right into the tomb and they're like, what's going on? And they're looking around and they peek inside. And now they're even more puzzled because there's no body. There's no body inside. And then they are completely freaked out when they encounter the heavenly messenger. Oh my goodness. In Mark, there's one young man who says, he is not here. He has been raised. This morning we read from Luke and we heard there were two angels in dazzling clothes who also said, why do you look for the living among the dead? Apparently that's some kind of snarky angel comment. But there in the garden, those women suddenly snap out of it. Suddenly, something has happened to their routine and regular world. It has been blown up. In their fear and in their confusion, that regularity, that routine has crumbled. And they will be spending the rest of their life reassembling it into something that looks like faith. They would remember all of a sudden what Jesus had told them again and again, repeatedly. He had said, the Son of Man is to be handed over, to be crucified, and on the third day, rise again. They would run back to their friends, silent at first, too scared to say anything. But finally, their story would get out and they would relate what they had seen and heard. And they would finally dare to believe it. Easter is here to blow us away. Most stories, they wrap up, they start finishing when the main character dies, right? But this one is just getting warmed up. Because in going to the cross, Jesus defeated death and the rule that death has over us. By rising from the dead, the promise of everlasting life for those who love God and neighbor becomes real and an invitation to every single one of us to jump in with our whole hearts and love like Jesus loved. He is risen to heal the world, to end the rule of death and the power of sin. And today we are here to tend to the body of Christ. Not just the body that was broken for us on the cross, but also the body of Christ that is alive in the world today. The body of Christian believers everywhere, of which we are a part. Those who are guided by the Holy Spirit and empowered and filled with God's gifts of love and joy. When we gather as the church, we are pulling together. We are united by that unseen spirit that comes from the love and heart of Jesus Christ. And through that, we support each other. Through that, we care for the poor and needy. And through that, we are made a part of the holy and healing life that Jesus lived and continues to live and transform the world. In our words and deeds, we can continue Christ's work to proclaim peace over conflict, justice over greed, and life over death. But we need him to be our Lord and Savior. We need him to forgive our sins and wash us and make us new. And then our loving welcome and acceptance of others can reflect that way that Jesus embraced the whole world on the cross. So if life ever seems like it's falling into a regular routine, just remember what Easter morning is about. Remember that we live in a world where God lived and died and rose again. If the days ever seem to just follow one after another with dull regularity, remember this. You are a child of God. Remember that your name is written in God's book of life. Remember that together we are God's church and Easter people, and that our Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah. may rise now as we share our faith and confess it in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven.
Rejoicing that Jesus is risen and love has triumphed over fear, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need of good news. Holy God, we pray for the body of Christ, the church. Where the church is persecuted, protect it. Where the church is privileged, grant it humility. Where the church is fractured, heal it. Guide us all to embody Christ's love in the world. God of grace.
Hear our prayer.
Life-giving God, we pray for the earth, your good creation. Join our prayers with branches lifted in praise and roaring waters of new life, that together we may proclaim Easter hope. God of grace.
Hear our prayer.
Merciful God, we pray for all peoples and nations. Free oppressed communities from occupation, exploitation, and abuse. Teach leaders your way of justice. Empower peacemakers and all who work to end violence and strife. God of grace. Liberating God, we pray for people everywhere who long for good news. Roll away the stones that keep people from living with dignity and wholeness. Breathe new life and hope into people struggling to make it through each day. Especially we lift up Patricia Marie, Connie Algieri, Milani Bottles, Petra Chiamonte, Marianne Cromarty, Kay Edwards, Willie Escribano, Jeff Glau, Mabello Jones, Franklin Kuzmenko, Sonny Lefsted, Guy Lynn, Jordy Lynn, Violet Moore, Ginny Morris, Bev Pearsall, Wilfredo Rivera, Lucy Rodriguez, Ruben Reimer, Viva Simonette, Barb Turner, Patty Wallace, Marsha Weil, Yvette Williams, D. Cooper Rooney, Kathy Stripe, Cheryl Lemke, Reverend Roger Lemke, Beth Tepe, Les Tepe, Paul Erickson, Mary, Richard Bice, and the family of Roy Micelli, and those we name aloud or in our hearts. God of grace, loving God, we pray for this community of faith and for your Spirit in our midst. Feed us at your Easter table and fill us with your wisdom, that we may serve and care for others. God of grace. Eternal God, we remember those who have gone before us in death. Renew your trust, renew our trust in your promises, that we live with joyful courage and compassion. God of grace. Precious Lord, you make the renewal of our lives and loves possible through your grace. Be with those who are celebrating birthdays this week, including Olivia Armbrust, Kendall Kostialek, Michael Block, Mark Gamble, Bob Hembry, Woody Erickson, Jane Gamble, and those celebrating anniversaries. May they continue to know your joy and presence in all that the years may bring. God of grace. Into your hands, most merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love. Through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord.
And now may the peace of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, be with you always.
So with you.
Please take a moment from where you're standing and pivot around with a sign of welcome, a wave, a smile, a peace sign. Offer a sign of peace to those around you. May the peace of the Lord be with you this day and always. Amen. And you may be seated as we recognize the offering and it is brought forward. Thank you. We are grateful for all the offerings that you bring on behalf of our Lord Jesus. We thank you for leaving them in the basket as you came in. And if you didn't do so as you came in, you're welcome to do so as you leave today. For those of you who are with us on the live stream, this is a great opportunity for you to get your envelopes ready to mail in for the week. And you can also give online on our website using PayPal or on your phone using the Venco mobile app. Well, hopefully after you're done today, you'll linger a little bit. We've got a wonderful Easter breakfast that our youth and our men's group are cooking up for us in the Friendship Hall, just the building right out in front of this building. So if you go on out the front door and take a left, go through between the buildings and right into that hall, you will have a wonderful feast this morning. Also at 10:30, we're having our Easter egg hunt, courtesy of Julie Kaufman in our Sunday school. So that'll be a fun thing as well. We've got other activities coming up throughout the month. Coming up this Saturday, the men's group are going on a fishing outing. They're going to go to the Withlacoochee River State Park and spend the morning out there fishing in that beautiful park out there. We also have a group for seniors that has started meeting the second Monday of every month. From 11 to 1, they bring their lunches and have games and fellowship and all kinds of fun things happening with our seniors as well. We are putting together a series of workshops to work on some of our ministries that we have here at Atonement to find ways to improve them and some creative new things we can do. We're inviting speakers to come in from other churches and some lay people and some pastors that have experienced some good positive growth in their communities. So this first workshop that we're doing is April 13th, week from Saturday, and it's on Ministry of Inclusivity, of welcoming folks out in different marginalized communities in our community, how we can do a better job of that now that we are reconciling in Christ congregation that is dedicated to welcoming LGBT plus people and people of various ethnic backgrounds and differently abled folks as well. So this should be very interesting, and we hope we have a good group. We're going to be doing the workshop from 10 to 2 with lunch at noon for everybody. And there's a sign-up sheet out in the entryway for all who'd like to be a part of that. At this time, we shift our attention to the table of welcome behind me, to the altar where Jesus comes and gives himself to us, his body, his blood, in the bread and wine. He invites us all to come forward and receive his love and mercy in this gift. If you're less mobile and want to stay where you're at, that is fine. We can come around to you after everybody else has gone through the line. We also have gluten-free wafers for those who would prefer that. Or if you would prefer grape juice to the wine, just let us know when you come up, and that is available as well. Let us now prepare our hearts to receive our Savior Jesus, who comes to us in Holy Communion. Please rise. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Indeed, holy, O God, the fountain of all holiness. You bring light from darkness, life from death, speech from silence. We worship you for our lives and for the world you give us. And we thank you for the new world to come and for the love that will rule all in all. We praise you for the grace shown to Israel, your chosen, the people of your promise, the rescue from Egypt, the gift of the promised land, the memory of the fathers, the homecoming from exile, and the prophet's words that will not be in vain. In all this, we bless you for your only begotten Son, who fulfilled and will fulfill all your promises. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and blessed it and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he come.
Christ is died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Therefore, O God, with this bread and cup, we remember the incarnation of your Son, his human birth and the covenant he made with us. We remember the sacrifice of his life, his eating with outcasts and sinners, and his acceptance of death. But chiefly on this day, we remember his rising from the tomb, his ascension to the seat of power, and his sending of the holy and life-giving Spirit. We cry out for the resurrection of our lives, when Christ will come again in beauty and power to share with us the great and promised feast. Amen.
Come, Lord Jesus.
Send now, we pray, your Holy Spirit, that we and all who share in this bread and cup may be united in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, may enter the fullness of the kingdom of heaven, and may receive our inheritance with all your saints in light. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Join our prayers with those of your servants of every time and every place, and unite them with the ceaseless petitions of our great high priest until he comes as victorious Lord of all.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Shepherding God, you have prepared a table before us and nourished us with your love. Send us forth from this banquet to proclaim your goodness and share the abundant mercy of Jesus, our Redeemer and friend.
Amen. Please rise for the blessing. Hallelujah! Jesus Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed.
Hallelujah.
The God of resurrection power, the Christ of unending joy, and the Spirit of Easter hope bless you now and always. Amen.